I've been doing research on sign language acquisition for my whole academic career. I happen to be a hearing native signer of American Sign Language. I grew up in an all-deaf family, and I've always been fascinated by the process of children learning and using a sign language. Some years ago, I had the good fortune to be part of a research team at the Science of Learning Center on Visual Language and Visual Learning, based at Gallaudet University, a university dedicated to deaf and hard of hearing students through education and research. At this National Science Foundation funded center, a team of deaf and hearing scientists was able to explore the different ways that humans adapt to the language environments that are visual and not auditory. We had the intuition that the eye gaze behavior of deaf infants may look different from hearing infants. So we reached out to another Science of Learning Center at the University of Washington, where Rochelle Brooks and Andrew Meltzoff have conducted eye gaze behavior studies with over 1,000 hearing infants. Through their experiments at the University of Washington Institute for Learning and Brain Sciences, they have established a fairly precise timeline characterizing when a typically developing hearing infant demonstrates the ability to follow the gaze, the eye gaze of an adult. Based on prior studies of deaf parents interacting with their deaf infants, we know that through sign language, the parent offers their child a host of visual and bodily cues, even before the child has started signing. With such rich and early patterns of visual engagement, what we refer to as a visual ecology, we hypothesize that perhaps gaze following was enhanced in deaf infants raised by deaf parents. This research collaboration with infant gaze following experts Brooks and Meltzoff enabled us to ask this question experimentally. We traveled all around the country to find 7 to 20 month old deaf infants born to deaf parents who experienced sign language from birth. Remember, this group makes up less than 5% of the population of deaf infants. We then compared the experimental results from these deaf infants to a large group of age-matched hearing infants from Brooks and Meltzoff's University of Washington research lab.
During the study, the experimenter sits across from the infant seated on the parent's lap. The experimenter shifts her gaze toward one of two toys. There is one placed to her left, and the other is placed to her right. Then we check to see whether the infant follows her gaze. Here, a young deaf infant successfully follows the experimenter's gaze. In contrast, a hearing infant of the same age will rarely do so. She will, but most likely she will gaze follow closer to her first birthday. Not only did deaf infants excel at following an adult's gaze to a specific object, but they also demonstrated more advanced checking back behavior, or looking back to the adult for more information. The finding that this infant behavior can be shaped through experience is a significant observation, one that pushes us to consider both infants' natural motivation to communicate with others and their flexibility of learning to communicate through a variety of modalities.
We concluded that both hearing and deaf children adapt to their language environments, whether it is signed or spoken. Importantly, our findings counter the often held deficit view of deaf children. Compared to hearing infants, the deaf sign language exposed infants in our study were advanced in this important ability that we consider foundational for social, cognitive, and linguistic development.